There truly is trouble in Blobalonia, in episode 111 of Game Boy Works. As we wind down this quote-unquote season of Game Boy Works, we have one last NES to Game Boy sequel to look at. Well, semi-sequel. It's really more of a trimmed-down remix, if we're being honest. The Rescue of Princess Blobette, or if you prefer its mouthful of a full title, David Crane's The Rescue of Princess Blobette Starring a Boy and His Blob, follows on the heels of games like F1 Race, Ninja Boy, and even DuckTales in being quite faithful to an NES game, but not as good. I suppose that should come as a little real surprise, though. The only NES to Game Boy follow-up we've seen so far that I would classify as unquestionably superior to the console game is Balloon Kid, which included all the cool stuff from the NES game Balloon Fight, and added a full quest mode to it on top of that. Princess Blobette, on the other hand, is more along the lines of what we've come to expect from this particular branch of Game Boy software. I hate to bag on a game that bears the name of a pioneering designer like David Crane, but Princess Blobette is not really his best work. In every sense, this feels like a worse version of the NES game. Take the music, for example. The Boy and His Blob on NES had only a few tracks, but they were bangers. Aside from one very annoying high-pitched rhythmic element, the soundtrack to the NES game was rich, layered, and featured some fantastic drum samples. The Game Boy soundtrack, despite the handheld's strong audio capabilities, amounts to tinny, flat renditions of those same tracks. In fact, this is a great metaphor for the game itself. Princess Blobette takes basically the entirety of the NES game and shrinks it down to about one-third the size. It carries forward all the mechanics of the NES game, as well as the graphics. Now, given the leisurely pace of the game, this is one of those rare instances where the developer's reuse of NES sprites doesn't really hurt all that much. Unfortunately, Princess Blobette carries forward all the lousy design elements and maddening frustrations of the NES game as well. It's like a concentrated dose of unfairness and clumsy bumbling. There's a lot to like about the concept behind A Boy and His Blob. It's an adventure game in the guise of a free-roaming, almost Metroidvania-like platformer. It's also one of the first games to involve a true AI companion character. The titular boy can't really do all that much on his own, not even jump. He just walks around and hucks jelly beans, basically. All the heavy lifting here is handled by the Blob, a weird white lump that kind of looks like a snowman that's been cursed with a human face. The Blob cheerfully follows the boy around and takes no initiative of its own, forcing the player to make all the decisions here. For some mysterious reason, though, tossing a jelly bean at the Blob will cause it to transform into different objects based on the flavor of the bean. Completing the game then amounts to making tactical use of your jelly bean reserves in order to solve various puzzles and safely navigate a sprawling maze of pits and monsters. The same holds true here, but the world is a lot smaller on Game Boy. The NES game spanned several levels, beginning with a massive maze of caverns beneath the boy's hometown, and eventually leading to the Blob's homeworld. Princess Blobette takes place entirely inside a castle on that homeworld, and your task is simply to rescue the eponymous princess, who has been suspended in a birdcage high above a boiling stew pot. Unlike in the NES game, there's no final boss to worry about. Rescuing Blobette is pretty much a cut-and-dried task that amounts to freezing the cauldron and having the Blob unlock her cage. Again, it's a compact game. If you know what you're doing, you can easily clear it within the space of 20 minutes, maybe less. For those seeking to do a little more with their $30 video game investment, Princess Blobette also follows in the footsteps of the NES game by incorporating a hidden treasure hunt. The counter at the top of the screen indicates the number of treasures scattered throughout the game, and it decrements every time you find one. Like so many things about A Boy and His Blob, this calls back to Crane's breakout hit, Pitfall. The NES game in a lot of ways felt like Pitfall for the NES audience. It's more colorful and cartoonish, and it has a more structured layout and purpose. But the premise, overcoming environmental hazards and finding underground loot, comes straight from that Atari 2600 masterpiece. Unfortunately, the Blob games also feel a lot more unfair and based on trial and error than Pitfall did. Pitfall was tough to be sure, but it always felt more or less fair. The challenge of the game came down to a certain degree from navigating the jungle's hazards. But the real task at hand was to learn the ins and outs of the game world and uncover the location of all its treasures, then figure out a path that would allow you to collect them within the time limit. Boy and His Blob lacked a time limit, so it compensated for this relaxing sense of freedom by constantly screwing over the player with trial and error traps. Consider the opening area in which you needed to descend into the subway, and then create a hole in the floor to allow you to reach the underground caverns beneath the city. There's no way to see the layout of the caverns from inside the subway, or even any way to know that something exists beneath the subway station that you need to seek out in the first place. So even if you figure out the fact that you need to drop through the floor into an unseen cave, it's impossible to know where you can drop safely. The entire game plays out like this, expecting players to sacrifice life after life as they slowly sound out the proper path to victory. That's one way to extend playtime, I suppose, but it's not a great way. Princess Blobette doesn't have quite as much of this trial and error design, but that's only because its world is so much smaller than on NES. Instead, its difficulty comes from the fact that it's so hard to convince the blob to move exactly where you need it to. Since you have no direct control over the blob, you're forced to rely on its AI to guide it where it needs to be in order to properly line up a transformation to allow you to climb or descend to another screen. This is the single most difficult thing in the entire game, and it's made worse by the blob's physics, which prevent it from occupying the same space as the boy. If the blob decides to stand where the boy gets shoved out of the way to make room. This is one area where the NES sprite proportions do cause problems on the Game Boy screen. Platforms in this game tend to be a lot more narrow than they were on NES. The blob has a maddening tendency to bump you off the side of tiny ledges, sometimes to your death. The game's jellybean transformation mechanic carries forward almost one-to-one from the NES game. This is the most clever concept in the game, as it forces players to experiment with a limited set of tools in order to solve puzzles. I don't know that the puzzles here really live up to the concept, though. In fact, there's one jellybean, the Revere Rocket, that you never actually need to use, and in fact, if you use it in the wrong place, you'll instantly lose the game. I do genuinely love the dad joke designations for the jellybean transformations. Some of the correlations between flavor and transformation are just kind of there. Like, mint turns the blob into a patch of ice, because mint is cool and refreshing, I guess. Cola-flavored beans turn the blob into a bubble, because cola is fizzy. And coconut jelly beans turn the blob into a coconut. Others, however, have built-in puns. Need a key? Feed the blob a lime jelly bean, because, you know, key limes. Need a monkey wrench to throw a spanner into the works? Try a banana beans, because monkeys love bananas. The bean mechanic here does come with the same annoying user interface choice as on NES. The heads-up display at the bottom of the screen lists the flavor and quantity of your currently selected bean, but for some ridiculous reason it only describes the bean's transformation power when that power is currently in effect. I get the value in the process of discovery, but would it have been so hard to retain the effect info for quick reference once you've experimented with that bean and discovered its power? Since you annoyingly have to select beans by cycling through the list of 14 one by one, a little tweak to make that process slightly friendlier would have been welcome. This isn't a game breaker, but it does demonstrate the rough edges that should have been sanded down in converting the game from NES to Game Boy. Still, the rescue of Princess Blobette is almost laughably easy if you've completed the NES game, since it doesn't really introduce any new elements or ideas to the mix. The blob has the same transformations, and you have to deal with the same set of puzzles and hazards. Water, monsters, crushing machines, levers, and that boiling pot at the game's end. It's frustrating because the premise behind A Boy and His Blob is really strong, and this sequel or remix could have been really great with a little more time and consideration. I mean, look at WayForward's take on the game from about a decade ago. It's both charming, substantial, and vastly more fair. Unfortunately, this feels like a project that was hustled out the door as quickly as possible for as little money as possible. Much like the in-game world here, the staff list is a bit smaller than that of the NES game. So rather than giving A Boy and His Blob a proper portable follow-up, it feels like Absolute and Imagineering went for a quick, low-budget release to strike while the Game Boy market was heating up. I don't know, this is an acceptable take on the NES game, but only just. This isn't the last Imagineering-developed title we'll see for Game Boy, but the rest mostly consist of productivity apps and Simpsons ports from NES. So maybe don't hold your breath for greatness, is what I'm saying. Next time, we wrap up the current season of Game Boy Works by getting cursed. Spooky!